Now, tonight we're going to be doing something a little bit different. I don't know if anybody has heard me talk about this yet. How many people have heard this talk on the historical critique of the early Islam? Have any of you heard this? Okay, a few of you. This is going to be new for most of you. It was new for me back in 1994. So I have been working with this material for over 100 years. Back in 1994, I was studying here at School of Oriental and African Studies. I thought I knew everything about Islam, and I was studying under the tutelage of Dr. Gerald Hotting. Dr. Gerald Hotting was head of department at that time in 1994 at SOAS. And he started introducing some new material that I'd never heard before, some new historical findings that were coming out that not only upset everything I had heard about Islam, but it upset the Muslims in the class as well. There were about 20 Muslims in the class of around 50. And within 2 weeks, all the Muslims had left except two, many of them slamming the door as they left. They were so upset with what they were hearing. Now, some of that material I'm going to introduce tonight, you need to hear it. It's important. Because what I'm going to do tonight is what was done about, really, against our Bible, and legitimately so, back in the 1800s, when people started asking the same questions about the Bible. Can we look and see whether or not these people called, well, Abraham, for instance, did he actually exist? Is there somebody, are there customs that we can look at? Are there things that actually place him in the 19th century or 1900 BC outside of the Bible that support what he said, what he did? The same thing with Moses, the same thing with David. Moses in 1400 BC, David in 1000 BC. And back in the 1800s, when these questions came up, the church wasn't ready for it. We had not really asked these questions, and shame on us for not doing so. And I think every religion that claims to be historical, as almost every religion does, every religion has historical characters that live in a place, doing certain events at a certain time. Names, dates, places, and events. Those are the four historical questions we should ask of every book, not just the Bible, the Upanishads, the Vedas, the Bhagavad Gita, the Book of Mormon, the Granth Sahib, all of these different books that are claimed to be religious books, and certainly of the Quran. So what we're going to do today is all these questions that have been asked of the Bible. In fact, it was the Bible that almost every one of these questions were first asked. No, it really didn't exist before the Bible. There was no historical criticism before biblical criticism was created. Historical criticism is biblical criticism, or you might say the other way around. Biblical criticism is historical criticism. Redacted criticism, source criticism, all these literary criticisms were all applied to the Bible first, and now for the first time, we're applying them to Islam. And this is what Gerald Hotting was introducing me back in 1994. So let's do that. Let's unpack it. And we're going to go through and start showing you what we're now finding. Now, what I'm going to say tonight, I may not say in a year from now. The reason why is because there is so much new material coming down the pike. Even when I gave this talk in California in 2013, there is much that I've now improved, the many things that are moving on, because we're coming across so much material on Islam that we didn't know about even 2 years ago or 3 years ago. So let's open it up and let's talk about what we're talking about. Well, let's say the first thing that every Muslim will say is, and they all agree with this, is that Muhammad is the last and greatest prophet. I don't think there's any Muslim that would say any different other than maybe your liberal Muslims. They would also say the Quran was his revelation, sent down only to him between 610 and 632. It's the final revelation. It's the greatest revelation. It's the seal of all revelations, like Muhammad is the seal of all prophets. He is the final prophet. Whether you are radical, whether you are nominal, maybe not the liberals. And many of the liberals are starting to question. In fact, many of the liberals here in Britain are starting to ask the questions I'm going to ask tonight. But certainly, 99% of Muslims around the world would all agree that Muhammad is the greatest prophet, the final prophet, and the Quran is the greatest revelation, the final revelation. Therefore, Islam is the final religion based on Muhammad's life and sayings, the Sunnah, and on the Quran's teachings. Remember last week we talked about the whole paradigm that was introduced by Ibn Taymiyyah in the 1300s, that paradigm that suggested and also acclaimed, to be a good Muslim, you must go back to the Quran, modeled by Muhammad, the book of the man, the book of the man, the book of the man, right? Remember that? I think I said it so many times, it almost got plastered on my lips. And you probably walked away thinking that's all I can talk about, the book of the man, the book of the man. Because we start from the same paradigm, the book of the man. It's just another book, another man. So what I want to do today is I want to look at the man. Let's look at that man. Next week, we're going to look at the book. I'm going to start with the man. I'm going to start with Muhammad. I'm going to start with his biography. And then next week, we're going to unpack the Quran, which gets even better. All right? And to do that, let's see, of course, why am I doing that? Is because these are the foundations of Islam. It is the Quran that is the book. It is Muhammad that is the man. So let's investigate both Muhammad and the Quran. Now, what's the classical account? This is the account that you've all heard. This is what you're taught in every school. This is still what is being taught in every university. It's still being taught in most every corner of the world. This is the classical account that you've only, and this is one you'll agree with. You've never heard any other story. You've all been told that Muhammad was born in 570. Has anybody heard any different? No. There's no reason not to hear any different, because that's all that we've ever heard. We also have been told that in 610, he was going up, he went away from Mecca, he went to the Hira cave, which he would go there quite often to meditate, and there in the middle of the, while he was meditating, suddenly an angel appeared to him, Jibril, and says, Akra, that means recite. His response was, Ma'akra, I cannot recite, because he could not read or write. So the angel squeezed him, then said a second time, Akra. And his response was, Ma'akara, I cannot read or write. And he was squeezed a second time. This happened three times. Finally, the angel let him go, and he ran back to Mecca, went to Khadija, his only wife at that time. Khadija was the woman that was very wealthy. She had her own caravans. She employed Muhammad as her caravan leader. She married him. And she had a little test for him when he came back. She asked him to first sit on one leg and asked him, was this an angel that talked to you? He said, yes. She asked him to sit on the other leg and said, are you sure this was an angel that talked to you? She said, he said, yes. She finally disrobed in front of him and then asked a third time, were you sure that this was an angel? And he said, yes. After that, she knew he was telling the truth because no angel would ever be in her presence disrobed. So she went and told her cousin, Waraka ibn Nawfal, what Muhammad had said. Waraka ibn Nawfal was a Nestorian Christian, so we're told, according to traditions. And it was Waraka ibn Nawfal that then turned to Muhammad and said, truly, what has happened to you? You have been seen by an angel. This is a revelation that is coming to him, that you are a prophet. Interestingly, it's a Nestorian Christian that gives the authority for Muhammad as a prophet, one of the ironies of history. After that happened, then many revelations started to come from 610 on, and we call these the Meccan revelations. Up from 610 to 622, he started receiving these revelations that are in the second part of the book, the latter part of the Quran. In 621, he woke up in the middle of the night and he was told by the angel to get on the back of a winged horse called the Burak, which flew him up to Jerusalem. And there at the rock, where the dome is now built, the Dome of the Rock, at that rock he then ascended to seven heavens, met Allah. Allah said to pray 50 times a day. So he came down to the fifth heaven, met Moses, and asked him how many times he'd ask you to pray. He said, 50. Ah, that's way too many. Go back up and see if you can get it down. So he goes back up to Allah and gets it down to 45. He comes in down to the fifth heaven, and Moses, see if you can get it down more. And so he bounced back and forth between the seventh and the fifth heaven, bringing it down from 45 to 40 to 35, down to 15, 10, and finally five prayers. Once he got it to five prayers, then Moses says, fine, go on back down to earth, which he did. Which is one of the another ironies of history, that the reason why Muslims pray five times a day is because of Moses. Isn't that fascinating? And this all happened in 621. Am I changing the story, or have you all heard this story? So far, I've kept exactly to what every Muslim will tell you. In 622 then, he then moves from Mecca up to Medina. This is called the Hijrah, the Exodus. And he moves, some of the traditions say there were 80 of his followers, others say there were 200. Nonetheless, he had a small group of men and women that he moved with, called the Hijrah. He moves up to Medina, and then the reason why he goes to Medina is because the Ansar, the natives of Medina, they were having problems with the Jews who controlled all the commerce. They needed someone who was neutral to arbitrate between them, and so that's why they brought Muhammad up. He was neutral. So he was there as an arbiter between the Ansar, the Arabs, and the Jews. Now, that arbitration happened for about 2 years. That continued for 2 years from 622 to 624. It didn't work because after 624, then, that arbitration broke down. He still continued to receive revelations, and these revelations continued from 622 to 632, the last 10 years of his life. Once these arbitrations broke down, once the Jews no longer accepted him as a prophet, he no longer accepted them. And that's where the problems began between Muhammad and the Jews. And we talked about that last week, so I don't need to go through that. You know what I'm talking about. In 630 then, he goes from Medina and he just walks right into Mecca and takes it over. No war, no battle, he takes it over. And then he dies in 632. Some say he was poisoned, but what we do know is that he did die, and that's at that time the Quran had yet been written down. It had been memorized by many of the companions. Some had parts of it had been written on bones, stones, some had been written on bark, but it had not been written down completely when he died. After he died, Abu Bakr takes over. Abu Bakr rules from 632 to 644. 634, he dies normally. Then Umar takes over, and he goes and rules from 634 to 644 the next 10 years. He then is killed. Uthman takes over, and he then rules from 644 to 656. It's during his ruling, the third caliph, his ruling, that the Quran was written down. We're going to talk more about that next week because that's problematic. 650 to 652 is when the Quran was finally written down, roughly 18 to 20 years after Muhammad's death. This is what the classical account says. This is what I've been taught. This is what you've been taught. This is the only story you're going to hear. And then Uthman is killed, and Ali, the adopted son of Muhammad, then takes over, and he is considered to be the legitimate heir because he is adopted by Muhammad. Muhammad didn't have any heirs. He had two sons, but they died in childbirth. He had four daughters, but they could not be his heirs. And that's why Ali had to be his heir. Ali then takes over, and then he is killed at the Battle of Siffin in 661. Now, that is the story you've all heard. Have any of you heard any other story? No, I don't hear and see any hands. For a very good reason. There is no other narrative. That's the only narrative we're given. There you can see now where this is all happening. It's all happening in this red area here. From the birth of Muhammad in 570 up until the death of Muhammad in 632, everything that took place during Muhammad's life is in that red area. Now, when should that have been written down? You would like to think it was written down, all this, everything I've just told you, should have been written down while Muhammad was still living, or immediately afterwards, right? You would like to think so. It would make sense, because we're not talking about a time when people could not read or write. People could read or write. Listen, the Bible had been written long before this. We have a copy of the New Testament right here in London from the 4th century. This is the 7th century. 300 years earlier, they had already written the Bible down, and certainly people could read or write in this part of the world. Why? Because take a look and see what they controlled. They now controlled the central part of Arabia. These people were merchants. They should have been able to read or write. Muhammad could not, but certainly Khadija could, his wife. And he has a secretary named Zayd ibn Thabit. Zayd ibn Thabit is his secretary. What do secretaries do? They write, don't they? By definition, he should have been able to read or write. So you would have hoped that someone could have written down all the story that I'm just telling you about in this period, or immediately after here. When do you think this story that I've just told you was written down? It wasn't written in that period at all. It wasn't written in the 7th century at all. Not even the same century that Muhammad lived. In fact, it first get written down by this man here, Ibn Ishaq, in 765. Muhammad died in 632. But we don't have any of his material. We're dependent on this man here, Ibn Hisham, to know about what Muhammad did. We have nothing before Ibn Hisham. And look at the date when he died, 833. 632, Muhammad dies. We have no biography of Muhammad until 833. That's 200 years later. Here you can just put it all, this is my own little timeline that I put in my own hand. So basically what we're saying is, everything we know about Muhammad, about what he did, doesn't get written down till over here, 200 years later. What about his sayings? Al-Bukhari is the one that first writes down his sayings. Al-Bukhari is given 600,000 akbars, 600,000 of these sayings, and he's to throw out those that were fraudulent. So he whittles them down, right down to 7,397. From 600,000, he whittles them down to 7,397. That's just 2%. He throws out 98% and only retains 2%. And when was that done? In 833. That's 240 years later. How did al-Bukhari know what to retain? How did al-Bukhari know what to throw out? Did he know Muhammad? No, he didn't. He lived 240 years later. Did he live in that area? No, he didn't. He lived hundreds of miles away and hundreds of years later. So why did it take them 240 years to write down what Muhammad said? What about the tafsir, which would be the commentaries on the Quran, which is what Muslims must need to, in order to know how to interpret the Quran? You have many, many tafsir. You have Al-Tabari. In fact, Al-Tabari is the first to write down a tafsir. Take a look at his date. 923. That's the 10th century. 300 years later, because Muhammad died in 632. It takes him 300 years to write the first commentaries on the Quran down. And the histories, the tahriq, which are all the histories of mankind leading up to Muhammad, they're first written down by Al-Tabari in 923. Again, the 10th century. Now, there are many that write after Al-Tabari. There's Baydawi, Zamakhshari, Suyuti. The names go on and on. But they all come after 923. Nothing before 923. So basically what we're saying is everything we know about Muhammad, everything we know about his life, everything we know about how the Quran was put together, everything we know about what he said that happened in this period here, does not get written down till this period, 200 to 300 years later. Does that bother any of you? Please say yes. It should bother all of you. Why? Well, can you imagine if we were to apply the same criteria to Jesus? Now, when did Jesus die? We know he died in about 33 AD. Did people write down what he did? Yes, they did. Almost immediately, didn't they? You have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, who wrote down the biography of Jesus. That would be the sira of Jesus, the siratu of Yesu or Isa. So you have the biographies written down. We know that Matthew, Mark, and Luke were written by between 48 and 64 AD. So within 30 to 40 years, you already have three biographies of Jesus. John would have been written later. That's about 60 years later. But two of those biographers actually knew Jesus. John and Matthew lived with him for 3 years. They saw everything he did. They heard everything he said. So they wrote down what they saw and they wrote down what they heard. We don't just have one biography, we have four biographies. Two of them written by eyewitnesses and the other two who got them from the eyewitnesses. 40 to 60 years after Christ's death. What about the tafsir of Jesus? That would be the commentaries. Well, the tafsir of Jesus would be the letters of Paul. He was the one that actually commented on what Jesus did. What Jesus did, he showed how to apply what Jesus did in Ephesus, in Philippi, in Corinth. Those are the commentaries on Jesus' life. And Paul was beginning to write down within 15 years of Jesus' death. Not 300 years, but within 15 years, Paul was writing down these tafsir of Jesus. Do you see the parallels? What about the tahriq, the histories of the early church? The book of Acts, written by Luke. And we know the book of Acts had to be written between 52 and 62 AD. Jesus died in 33 AD. So within 20 to 30 years, you have the Acts of the Apostles written. Which means everything we know about Jesus is written down within 15 to 60 years while the eyewitnesses were still living. John was still living. He was the last to write something down. Whereas everything we know about Muhammad is written 200 to 300 years after the fact. Ooh my, look at the differences. If we were dependent on what we know of Jesus concerning what Muslims are dependent on, that means, let me just go back, that means we would not know anything about Jesus until the 3rd century. How could we defend him? How could we even know what he did or said if nothing began to appear until the 3rd century? That's why I love my Bible. And that's why I love the person of Jesus Christ. That's why I can trust what I know about him, because they were written down so early. And you might say, hold on a minute, the first century, that's so early. Could people read or write? Listen, these were fishermen. How did they know how to read or write? Well, Matthew wasn't a fisherman. He knew how to read or write. And John used a scribe to write for him. Luke certainly was a doctor. He knew how to read or write. And Mark knew how to read and write. Of course they knew how to read or write. And Paul, goodness sakes, he was one of the most intelligent men of his day. Of course he knew how to read or write. So why could not the Muslims? Where were their Paul's, Luke's, John's, and Paul's? Sorry, I just said Paul. Matthew's and Mark's. Where are their readers and writers? Why could they not do the same thing in the 7th century? Or the 8th century? Why do we have to wait to the 9th century to have anything written down? Can you see why now historians are starting to look at the Quran, are starting to look at Islam, are starting to look at Muhammad with a completely new eye? And this is what they're asking. Islam as we know it did not exist in the 7th century, but evolved over a period of 200 to 300 years. The Quran probably was not revealed to one man in a 22-year period, like the classical count says, but likely evolved over a period of 50 to 100 years. We're going to deal with that one next week. Let's talk about the first one. Did not exist in the 7th century, but evolved over the period of 200 to 300 years. The conclusion they're coming to is the history of Islam, at least from the time of the Caliph Abdul Malik, and we're going to talk about more later tonight and before, is a later fabrication. Now, that's a huge amount to say, and you're probably, if there's any Muslims in the audience, they would get very angry with me for saying that. But let me just show you what we're doing and what we're saying. Here's the questions. This is their concerns. If so much of the history of early Islam was written down so late, why did it take so long to write it down? Were these people illiterate? I hear that all the time whenever I ask my Muslim friends this. They were illiterate. I said, hold on a minute. No, they weren't illiterate. By 642, within 10 years of Muhammad's death, Basra, Baghdad, Damascus, Jerusalem, and Cairo were controlled by Islam, or at least by Arabs. Those are huge cities. These had lots of libraries. They could read and write for hundreds of years, thousands of years in these cities. Please don't say no one knew how to read and write in those cities. By 685, by the time Abdul Malik comes to power, all of North Africa, all the way from Spain in the west, in the other direction, all the way to India in the east, that whole swath of land was under their control. Are you telling me that from Spain to India, nobody could read or write? Not one person? No, of course they could read or write. In fact, they tell me, we're going to find out next week, that the Quran was written down by Zayd ibn Thabit in 632 to 634. Within 2 years of Muhammad's death, the Quran was first written down by a man named Zayd ibn Thabit, who was the scribe of Muhammad, the secretary of Muhammad. His whole job was to read and write. So where did the 9th century biographers get their material from? And since we don't have anything before the 9th century, can we trust it? Since it's so late, shouldn't we go back to the period these events took place? Shouldn't we go back to the 7th century and see what we find? And that's, as a historian, is what we need to do. Let's go back and see what we can find in the 7th century. And that's what now a whole slew of historians have begun to do, especially here in Britain. This is coming out of Europe more so than America. And this is why I heard nothing about this when I was in America. I only started hearing this in 1994. And that's why we've been working with this now for the last 20 years. And the people I'm going to go to are these scholars. Dr. John Wansborough, head of department at School of Oriental and African Studies here in the University of London, wrote two books, Quranic Studies and Sectarian Milieu, in 1977 and 1978. And it's those two books that broke open this whole question. And he asked some very simple questions. Questions that should have been asked hundreds of years ago. If when you look at the Quran, take a look at all the stories in the Quran, they just don't make sense for a 7th century environment. They make much more sense once the Muslims or the Arabs had moved out into the diaspora, where they would have come across these stories. Because these stories, actually, we know where the stories come from. Story of Cain and Abel in Surah 5, Ayah 31. That comes from the Targum of Jonathan ben Hosea. The story of Abraham in Surah 21, Ayah 51 to 71. A great story of, but it does not come from the Bible. It actually comes from the Mishnah Rabbah. The story of Solomon and Sheba in Surah 27, Ayah 17 to 44. A terrific story with the hoopoe bird and the Queen of Sheba pulling up her skirts and she has hairy legs. That story does not come at all from my Bible. I don't remember her ever pulling up her skirts. Nor do I remember a hoopoe bird that could talk. Or that Solomon, who had created an entire air force that would drop stones on the enemy with the name of the enemy at the bottom of the stones. This is not in my Bible. I would have loved to have had that story in Sunday school for one very good reason. It's from the second Targum of Esther, which is written in the second century. It was nothing more than an apocryphal account written by the Jews in the second century and nothing more than as entertainment for their children. Yet you find it in Surah 27, Ayah 17 to 44. They shouldn't have ever put it in the Quran. This does not come from God. It doesn't even come from His scripture. It comes from nothing more than a folktale for children. So Wandsbury was asking these questions in 1977. In 1978. Dr. Gerald Haunting, my professor at School of Oriental Infant Studies, is one that has probably done the best job of looking at the first century and unpacking what we now know. Dr. Patricia Krona used to study under Dr. Don Wandsborough. She then went and became head of department at Oxford University, wrote a book called Meccan Trade and the Rise of Islam. We're going to use some of her work tonight. She got a death threat from Muslims for writing that book in 1987. Moved to Cambridge University, and that's where I got to know her. I did a debate on this material in 1995. So you can see, this is over 20 years ago that I did this. Did I say 100? 20 years ago, I'm not that old yet. 20 years ago, I did a debate on this material with Dr. Jamal Badawi, the head scholar of his day in the Muslim world in 1990s. And I asked 10 questions that I got from Dr. Patricia Krona. Dr. Patricia Krona was head of department at Cambridge University at that time. She was the one that helped me put that debate together. Dr. Patricia Krona reads and writes 15 archaic languages. These are languages that are not spoken anymore today. 15 of them she reads and writes. She is considered to be the top in the world in her field. How many of you can read and write even modern day 15 languages? Can you see the kind of scholarship we're dealing with here? She finally left and went to Princeton University, was head of a department at Princeton University before she died just a few months ago. But it is her material that blew this all open, as you're going to see later on in our talk today. Dr. Andrew Rippon was University of Calgary, was probably the best one that took it, all this material and brought it down to layman's terminology so the rest of us could understand it. Dr. Robert Hoyland, head of department when I knew him at Oxford University, does the best job of taking all the extra Quranic and extra Arabic material and puts it together and says, what kind of people are we talking about? What kind of places are we talking about in the 7th century? He reads and writes 18 languages. These are linguists. These are the top scholars in the world who have now geared their material on the Quran. Dr. Yehuda Neva, head of department at Jerusalem University, who has done the best work at looking at all the inscriptions from that part of the world and transcribing them and showing us that we've got a real problem when we look at the earliest Arab inscriptions. I'll be using some of his material later on. And then the German school. The Germans have been way ahead of everybody else when it comes to the manuscript evidence. And I'll be dealing with them more next week. Dr. Hans Luling. Dr. Gerd Pwin, Dr. von Bothmer, and Dr. Oleg, they're the ones who actually looked at the earliest manuscripts, which we'll talk about next week. But these are scholars, top scholars in the world, who are now using their expertise, asking the same questions about that had been asked about the Bible. Dr. Gerald Haunting, the first day of class, he said, you know, I've spent 20 years confronting the Bible. 20 years using redacted criticism, using source criticism, using historical criticism, using literary criticism against the Bible. I finally gave up after 20 years. But since I had all these different criticisms, since I had all this scholarship under my belt, I just started taking the same material and applying it to the Quran and to the early emergence of the Quran. And that's why 20 Muslims had to leave his class. Because of what he was telling us and what he was saying. So, two new books have come out and one documentary here in Britain that you need to know about that you can get. One of them is In the Shadow of the Sword. How many of you know about this book? In the Shadow of the Sword, written by Dr. Tom Holland. Now, Dr. Tom Holland is not a historian. He got his doctorate in English literature. But he's a great storyteller, and he has written all kinds of historical books. In fact, almost every one of his books have been bestsellers. He came out with this book in 2012 after spending 6 years of studying the emergence of Islam, because he'd written Rubicon, he'd written Persian Fire, he had written, what was the one on the Byzantine world? Anybody know the third one that he's written? Rubicon, Persian Fire, and I can't remember the third one. But those are all the histories leading up to Islam. So he is the best place to write the next chapter. How did Islam begin? And he went to all these different scholars, Krohn, Hotting, Hoyland, went to Pwin, and many of the German scholars, and he just asked them for their material. Then he took the material and put it into a book that we could read. That book came out in 2012, asking the historical questions that should have been asked by Muslims throughout the centuries. Looked at the sources, the Islamic sources, and pointed to Quranic incongruities. Then he did a documentary called Islam, the Untold Story. Have any of you seen that documentary? Did you see it when it first came out? It didn't come out except once. It was only shown once on Channel 4 on August 28, 2012 at 9 p.m. It was not permitted to be shown a second time. Channel 4 would not show it a second time because of all the furore from the Muslims here in Britain. You can still go up online. You can get it on YouTube. I have it on my computer if anybody wants it. It's only 90 minutes long. And what he did, he took much of the material from In the Shadow of the Sword and put it together into a 90-minute broadcast. But he did not come to conclusions. He was very careful not to come to conclusions. And he did not touch the Quran. He did not want to touch the Quran. You'll see why next week. And then probably the best material that's come out is by this man, Dr. Dan Gibson, who wrote Quranic Geography. You can get it online. He's now putting it together into a movie. Quranic Geography came out, I think it was in 2011. And what he did is he started to look and see how Islam actually began. Dan Gibson is an archaeologist. His father is an archaeologist. His grandfather was an archaeologist. He lived amongst the Bedouins there in the Middle East for 20 years, learned their language, and then tried to go around trying to find out where all the geographical locations in the Quran were there in the Middle East. We're going to talk about him a little later because some of his material is absolutely earth-shattering. This is what they're finding. I'm just going to introduce this to you, and then we're going to come back to it. What they found is this. The first Arab inscription referencing Muhammad is not till 691. Muhammad died in 632. Isn't that interesting? There's no Arab reference to Muhammad earlier than 691. That's 60 years after he died. The first reference to Muslim, the word Muslim, is not till the 690s. So what did these people who were destroying and taking over Basra, Baghdad, Damascus, Jerusalem, and Cairo, what did they call themselves? Well, they called themselves Saracen, which is the Arab name for these people. They call themselves Hagarin because they are in the line of Hagar. They call themselves Ishmaelite because they are in a line through Hagar down to Ishmael, so therefore they would be in that line. They call themselves Maghreb because they come from the Maghreb, and they call themselves Mahajirun. These are the names they call themselves, those five names. The Mahajirun means people of the Hijr, people of the Exodus, people who are nomadic. The first reference to the word Islam is not till 691 on the Dome of the Rock, there in Jerusalem. And the first reference to the city of Mecca is not till 741. Muhammad died in 632. As you know, as I already said, the first biography of Muhammad is not till 833. Now let's unpack this and let's see what we're talking about. And let's start with Dan Gibson's material. Now Dan Gibson, when he was looking at the Quran, and you can do the same thing, he wanted to find out where the geographical locations were in the Quran. And he noticed there were 65 geographical locations. 9 places are named over and over again. And the names that come up over and over again are these people from Ad. 23 times it talks about this prophet who has contact and has relationship with these people from Ad. It doesn't mention who this prophet is. It just says the prophet, the messenger, the prophet, from the place of the prophet, from the place of the messenger. It doesn't refer to where he lives. Isn't that curious? In fact, you're not going to find reference to Muhammad. Oh, you will. They're in all the many, many references to Muhammad, take a look, you'll see they are all in parentheses, which means they've had to been put in at a later date. Muhammad's name is in Arabic is only found four times. Three times in one surah alone. Four times. How many times is Jesus found in the Quran? Try 93. So this messenger has contact with these people from Ad 23 times. 24 times he has contact with these people from Thamud. And seven times for these people from Midian. Ad, Thamud, Midian, where are they? Well, they're not around Mecca. They're way up here. 600 miles further north. But here's Mecca way down here. If he's living in Mecca, how come he's having these contacts, daily contacts with people that are 600 miles away? Put that under your hat and hold it a minute. Let's talk about Mecca. See, what we now know about Mecca, it's only referenced once in the entire Quran, and it talks about the Valley of Mecca in Surah 48, Ayah 24. That's it. No other time does it talk about this place. Well, what do we know about Mecca? Well, we know that there's also reference to Mecca. We don't know if that is Mecca. We know that if you look at the traditions and you add them with the Quranic material, we do know right there that it's in a valley. We know that there's a parallel valley where the Mecca is. We know that it has a stream going through it, that it has a pillar of salt outside of it, because when this prophet goes past in the morning, he passes the pillar of salt. That's the wife of Lot. And when he comes in the evening, he passes that same pillar of salt. More than that, we know that there are fields, clay, grass, trees, loam, and olive trees. That's curious. And that there are mountains overlooking the Kaaba. Now, take a look at every one of these references. None of these fit Mecca. Mecca is not in a valley. There is no parallel valley. There is no stream going through it. It only has one well, the Zamzam well. It could not have accommodated any caravans. It does not have tree, fields, clay, glass, or any suggestion of any olive trees, because olive trees only exist in the Mediterranean, 600 miles further north. There are no olive trees at all in the Arab Peninsula. So, all of these geographical references make no sense for Mecca. Now, according to Islam, Mecca is probably the oldest city in the world, because according to Surah 7, Ayah 24, when Adam and Eve, when they were up in the Garden of Eden, which is up in space, when they were thrown out of that garden, they were thrown down to earth. According to the traditions, it was Mecca that they were thrown down to. So it would be the earliest sanctuary for all of mankind. We also know in Surah 21 that Abraham is in Mecca. He is there and he goes into the Kaaba and he destroys the idols. That's in Surah 21. So in 1900 BC, Mecca should have existed if Abraham's there, right? We also know from all the traditions that Mecca was the center of trade north, south, east, and west. That's why it became rich. That's why Muhammad was there. He was a trader. So, it's the mother of all settlements, according to Surah 692, Surah 42, Ayah 5. Adam and Eve came from there, Abraham came from there, Muhammad was born there. And it's also where the Qibla, the direction of prayer, every mosque should be facing Mecca, correct? From 624 on, it should be the case, because we do know, according to Surah 2, Ayah 145 to 149, that Muhammad, when he moved to Medina in 622, he redirected the Qibla back up to Jerusalem so that it could accommodate the Jews. After 624, the Jews would not accept him as a prophet, so suddenly he gets a new revelation in Surah 2 to redirect the Qibla back down to Mecca. So from 624 on, every mosque should be facing Mecca, right? You getting that? Because there were no mosques before 624. He hadn't yet left Medina and Mecca. Yet we can only find one reference to Mecca in the Quran. That's in Surah 48, Ayah 24. Now, take a look at this Byzantine map of the trade route from the 7th century. What's missing? Can you find Mecca? This is a copy of a Byzantine map from the 7th century. Mecca isn't there. This is where Mecca should be, right here. It's not on the map. Here's a map of trade routes from the 7th century. These are Arab trade routes. These are not Byzantine trade routes. These are Arab trade routes. Where's Mecca? It's right where that question mark should be. When we look at the earliest maps, we can't find Mecca on any of the maps. This is the map that Patricia Corona looked at, and this is the one that got her curious. She was shown this map. This is a map that's not from the 7th century. It's a map that was made today in the 20th century, redacted back to the 7th century to show you what the place looked like. And when she looked at this map, she noticed that all the trade would have come from here in India and China further away. They couldn't go that way because of the Hindu Kush and the Himalayas. So all the trade used to come across the Arabian Sea over here into the Persian Gulf and used to go that direction up to the Mediterranean world. Are you following me there? The problem was, is that the Sassanids who were here were warring against the Byzantines who were there. So they were warring back and forth for 200 years from the 5th, 6th, and 7th century. So that shut down the trade from going up the Persian Gulf. They had to redirect the trade from India across the Arabian Sea down to here in Aden. And that's where they took off all the trade. They took it off the boat there, and they went 1,250 miles following that green line all the way up to Gaza in the north. That's a pretty good theory. That's called the trade route theory. Montgomery Watt was the one that came up with that theory. The Muslims love it, and they've grabbed onto it, and they're still using it today. Dr. Patricia Crone looked at this map. She says, hold on a minute, you've got a problem there. Let's see if any of you can find that problem. My 10-year-old son found it within 2 minutes. I'm not going to give you 2 minutes. Can any of you see a problem with that theory right there by looking at that map? No? No one's going to try? Should I give you a hint? Water. That's a pretty big hint. Go ahead, sir. Give him a hand. He's got it. You're as good as my 10-year-old son. That's true. If you're on road, if you're on boat here and you're coming across the Arabian Sea, why would you take off all the goods here? Dr. Patricia Crone found that if you go only 50 miles by land, it would cost the same amount if you went 1,250 miles by sea. You've got a sea right up here. Why didn't they continue on sea? That didn't make any sense. So she decided to go back and check this out. Now remember, she reads and writes 15 languages. So she went back to the original sources of all the trade documents. She went to the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. She went to all the centuries leading up until the 7th century, read their trading documents, looked at them in the original language, and she noticed that all the trade coming from India and China, all of it came right across the sea and went right up the Red Sea. And the Arabs had nothing to do with the trade because they did not like boats. They were camel herders. They liked the desert. That's why you don't have any ports along here. There was only one port that she could find. All the ports were on this side in Africa, and the people that controlled the trade were from this area, from Eritrea. It was Agilus. The name Agilus comes up over and over in all the documents. The documents, the trading documents that she found over here had Eritrean names or Ethiopian names, African names. They were the traders, which makes a lot of sense once you look at the map. Then she noticed something else. See if you can see this. I don't know if it's hard for you to see because it's so far away, but take a look at there. Here's the trade route, the line, the green line. It comes up to Taif. This is the Western Plateau, all the way up. And then from here in Taif, it goes off the plateau down to Mecca. There's Mecca. It's not on the plateau. It's about 1,000 meters off the plateau. They would have to go down to Mecca to go to a place that had no water, then come back up 1,000 meters to get up to Yathrib up here. Why had no one noticed that before? This is nothing new. It's been around for hundreds of years. Why did no one notice that Mecca's not on the trade route? It would have made no sense to be on the trade route. Why? Because it's too far down. It had no water. When you go from Sana, from Aden here, up to Najran and Sana, up to Taif, then you go straight up to Yathrib, Khaybar, Tabuk, and then on up to Gaza. Why had no one noticed this before? So she decided to look and see what was it that made Mecca, if it had anything, that made it rich. She was told, according to the trade route theory, that it had 15 spices, and that's why it became rich. So she wrote her book, and she decided to do study, research on all 15 spices. If you read her book, Meccan Trade and the Rise of Islam, she takes a spice per chapter, or a chapter per spice. And she found that none of the spices, except for two, even came from Arabia. They either came from India and China, or they came from Africa. The only two spices that came from Arabia were frankincense and myrrh. And they came from the southern part, the Hadramat, this part here, which is Yemen and Oman today. Nothing about any spice from this part of the world. The only trade she could find that were going up the Western Plateau was milk and leather. You cannot create an entire empire made out of milk and leather. Now, when she came out with this book, it blew open everything we knew about Mecca. She decided, well, let's find out what people knew about Mecca. So she went to every document she could find. She found documents written here in Ctesiphon, which is way up here. That is Baghdad, right up there. It's called Ctesiphon. That's the old name. They had come down here to Yathrib to find, and they came across silver. They had silver mines all over Yathrib. That's not too far from Mecca. Yathrib is what is Medina today. She looked at their documents. No reference to any place called Mecca. She couldn't find any reference from the first century, from the second century, from the third, fourth, fifth, sixth century, from the seventh century. No reference to Mecca. So when did she find Mecca? Not till 741. 741. Muhammad died in 632. She couldn't find any reference to Mecca earlier than 741. That's a whole over 100 years later. So what is this city? Where is this place that Adam and Eve were sent down to? Where is this Kaaba that supposedly Abraham rebuilt with Ishmael? In fact, she found out, not just see, Hitti found this out, in almost every one of those oases, in Najran, in Sana, in Taif, in Yathrib, in Tabuk, in Khaybar, all of these oases had Kaabas. It was quite normal to have a Kaaba. You have a Kaaba with gods in it, idols in it, then when the merchants would come along, they would go and pray to their idol and you would get money for it. It was a great way to enrich yourself. There wasn't just one Kaaba. There were many, many Kaabas. Why hadn't anybody noticed this before? Well, take a look at modern Mecca today. Maybe you've seen this picture. Look what they're doing to Mecca. They now have the third tallest building in the world in Mecca, this big clock tower. That clock tower now, that face is 45 feet across. It's the largest clock in the world, has four faces. It's the third highest building in the world. That was made by the Germans. They modeled it after Big Ben. That's Big Ben there. They have the same model. Why? Because they want to make Mecca the center of time. They wanted all of us to now move to Mecca Mean Time and take and get rid of Greenwich Mean Time. Have you heard this? That's why they built that clock tower. But they're not stopping there. Look what else they're building. This is the future of what Mecca is going to look like. These are their diagrams. There are two different plans, either this plan, which is circular, or that plan, which completely eradicates. And take a look what it's eradicating. There are the building cranes going on right now. Here is Muhammad's house, where he grew up, where he was born. They're now destroying his house. Here is Khadija's house, where his wife grew up. They're now destroying her house. Why are they destroying these houses? And why are they cementing it all up? Any idea? Because they've heard what we're finding. They now know that there is no historicity for Mecca. So what better way to destroy the evidence than to cement it up? Folks, can you see what's happening as we speak? Muslims all over the world are upset. But the Saudi Arabian government is continuing. They're going to build 62 of these buildings all around the Kaaba so that all the rich Muslims can have air conditioning when they come to do the Hajj. That's their reasoning for it. I would suggest the real reason is to destroy history, so there is no historical record, so you cannot confront them with this material. You can see why. Mecca did not exist before 741. It's too late. So if Mecca didn't exist before 741, what are you going to do with the Qibla, the direction of prayer? Every Muslim must pray towards Mecca, am I correct? And doesn't matter where you are in the world, you always pray towards Mecca, towards that building right there, the Qibla. This is the Kaaba, sorry. And it's that building. Whenever you go around the world, you will see there are all kinds of mechanisms to find out where Mecca is. That's in every mosque. You'll find a mihrab, which is a little niche in the wall that always shows you the direction of Mecca. I remember not too far from here in Cricklewood, they have taken over a nice, beautiful church. a brownstone church, and they invited me to come in. They took all, threw out all the stained glass window and replaced it with plexiglass. And then the imam wanted to show me, see, we've taken all the pews out and put down rugs, and now, Mr. Smith, now we have the Qibla going in this direction. He says, now we have corrected the church. It is now facing Mecca. They put a mihrab there in the wall over at the side. They wanted that for my own benefit, to show me that. When you go around, when I was in Malaysia, in my hotel room, in every hotel room, they had the Qibla in every hotel room. You can now use these objects to find the Qibla. You even have an app on our phones now to find where the Qibla is. Doesn't matter when you are, where you are in the world, you can always know where Mecca is. In Surah 2, Ayah 143 and 145, the direction of the Qibla was then redirected down to Mecca. That would be in 624, the date they give. But here's the problem. Archaeologists are having a difficulty. As early as 1905, two archaeologists, one called Dr. Creswell and Dr. Fetavadi, in 1905, were traveling in that part of the world. You can't go there anymore, but back then you could. And they were looking for the earliest mosques, and they wanted to go to find these mosques that were in the 7th century. So they went to mosques, one mosque in Wasit and another mosque in Kufa, which is in what is today Iraq. And they started digging down to the different layers till they got to the original floor plan of these two mosques. And when they found the original floor plan of both Wasit and Kufa, they noticed the Qibla was not facing Mecca. It was facing directly west. When they went to Egypt, outside Egypt is Fustat, the garrison town. When they went to the mosque in Fustat, just outside of Cairo, when they dug down to its original floor plan, they noticed that the Qibla was facing east. It should have been facing south. It should have been facing down here. But Kufa and Wasit were facing that direction. Fustat was facing this direction. So they said in 1905, it must be facing Jerusalem. That was their conclusion. And when I first found out about this back in 1994, even my professor, Dr. Hotting, when he brought this up, I raised my hand and says, well, what's your conclusion? He says, I don't want to come to any conclusion. I've already lost enough Muslims here for my class. I said, you've got to come to conclusions. If the earliest mosques that we've been able to find are facing west and east and not south, then it looks like we have a different Qibla. He would not, in class, say any more. But you can see immediately, if you look at the map, there's a problem here, isn't there? Now, Jacob of Edessa in 705 also said that the Qiblas, so from all this it is clear that it is not to the south that the Jews in the Maghreb is the name for the Arabs at that time, in the regions of Syria pray, but towards Jerusalem. He thought it was Jerusalem as well. He was actually wrong. Dr. Dan Gibson decided to pick up this argument. He had read about it. He'd heard about the debate I had had on it. He also knew about that this was a problem. He saw also that there was a problem. So he decided to do something that no one else had done. He decided to look at all the earliest mosques, but you can't go to the earliest mosques today and see where the Qibla is because they are all facing Mecca. Every mosque is facing Mecca, anywhere in the world. So he decided to use satellite technology to look down from space, to look and see where the original floor plans for all these mosques were. And guess what he found? I wanted to mention the three books that that Tom Holland had written. It's Rubicon, it's Persian Fire, and Millennium. That's the one I had forgotten. Millennium. So those three are all bestsellers. And those are the ones that gave him the platform to then go on and do In the Shadow of the Sword, because they all talk about the Roman world, the Byzantine world, and the Persian world, all of which ceased to exist in the 7th century. What took over? Islam took over. So he was the best qualified. Let's go back now to Dan Gibson, and let's talk about what he found. Remember, he goes and he wants to find out where all of these mosques were facing, using satellite technology, looking down on each of the mosques. This is what he found. When he looked at the great mosque in Guangzhou in China in 630, it's facing Petra, not Mecca. When he looked at the great Humaima Mosque, southwestern Jordan, the Qibla is facing Petra. It should be facing Mecca. The older mosque that was rebuilt then, he noticed there, the floor plan, finally was. The newer mosque, sorry. The great mosque at Baalbek in Lebanon, it's facing Petra. It should be facing Mecca. When he went to the great mosque of Sana'a in Yemen, the capital city of Yemen, right at the very bottom of the peninsula, built in 705. Now look at the date. All the Qiblas were supposed to be canonized in 624. So every mosque after 624 should be facing Mecca. But here's one built in 705, and it's facing Petra, not Mecca. This is an interesting one. This is in Jerusalem. Now you have the Dome of the Rock right here. That's the beautiful Dome of the Rock. Here you have the Al-Aqsa Mosque here. The Dome of the Rock is built in 691. The Al-Aqsa Mosque is built in 709. Look at the entire citadel, including both the Dome of the Rock and the Al-Aqsa, are all facing Petra. 691, 709. The entire citadel is facing Petra, the third most holy shrine in Islam. The Damascus Mosque, built in 709, it's facing Petra. It should be facing Mecca. The Anjar Mosque in Lebanon, look at the date, 714. It's facing Petra. It should be facing Mecca. The Mosque of Umar in Basra, now we're in Syria, 720. We're almost 100 years later. If the Qibla had its canonization in 624, this is 720. Almost 100 years later, it's still facing Petra, not Mecca. It's not till 727 that they finally found a mosque in Pakistan, Banbor in Pakistan, facing Mecca instead of Petra. This is over 100 years later. But then in 728, here you find a Qibla in the Qasr al-Hayr al-Sharqi in Syria. It's not facing Petra or Mecca. Looks like they're a little confused on this one. Now here's what's interesting. Take a look at this mosque from Amman in Jordan. This is the older mosque built in 700. It's facing Petra. They then rebuilt another mosque behind it and above it in 740. It now is facing Mecca the right way. So what happened between 700 and 740? That's the question we need to ask. The Mushta Mosque in Amman. Now we're in 743. It's back to Petra again. This is 120 years later. The Rabat. Now, when we get to North Africa, they don't seem to know where to face. Because in Tunisia, here's a fortress in Susa, Tunisia. In 770, it's not facing Petra or Mecca. It's facing directly south. They're a little confused in North Africa. The same way in Spain. Take a look at Spain. There's Petra. There's Mecca. It's facing quickly south. Obviously, there's something that we need to find out about North Africa and Spain as to why they're completely miscued. The Great Mosque in Karawin in Tunisia in 870. Now we're into the 9th century. See, these are much later mosques. In the 9th century, there seems to be some type of confusion here because they're not facing Petra or Mecca. It's facing straight south again, much like you found in other North Africa. But take a look at these. Were up until 725, every Qibla was facing Petra. And what's interesting is they were all uniformly facing Petra. I've heard Muslims try to say, well, they didn't know their direction at that time. Listen, these were camel herders. They went through the deserts. There were no roads in the deserts. And even the paths they used to take would be covered over by a sandstorm. So how did they know where to go? They used the stars. They were brilliant at knowing direction. Otherwise, they'd have died. You can't tell me they did not know where Petra was or where Mecca was. The fact that they're all facing Petra until 725 shows me. So from 622 to 725, every mosque he looked at was uniformly 100% facing Petra. Between 725 and 822, there seems to be a confusion. There seems to be something going on. We don't know what it is yet. But there were still backers and forings, especially in North Africa. They didn't know where to go. So 12% of the mosques were facing Petra. 50% started now to face Mecca. 38 were parallel or in other directions. And it isn't till 822 that every mosque begins to face Mecca. That's 200 years later. It takes them 200 years to get every mosque facing Mecca. Now we should ask, why is it that no one's known that before? That to me is hugely troubling. So why Petra? Well, take a look where Petra is. Remember that Arab trade route? I showed you where Petra, it's in the center of all the trade. See, Mecca's not even on the trade route map for one very good reason. There was no trade that went through Mecca. But Petra is on the center of every route. What is Petra known for? How many people have been to Petra? Has anybody been there? Okay, one man, two. What do you notice about Petra? It has tombs and temples. It was a center of the Nabataean kingdom. The Nabataeans, we know about the Nabataeans. They existed from the 2nd century BC. They existed, in fact, it's the Nabataean kingdom that we get the name Allah. Allah is a Nabataean god. The black stone that's in the Kaaba comes from Petra. What's more, Arabic, the language Arabic, comes from Nabataean script. They are the precursors to the Arabs. And yet all of their mosques and all of their temples all around the world were facing Petra up until 725. Let's take a look at Petra even closer. Look at Petra. It's in a valley. It has a parallel valley. It has a stream going right through it. It has fields, trees, grass, clay, loam. It has olive trees. It's near, if there is ever a pillar of salt that Lot's wife would have been, it would have been close to Petra, because that's exactly where that event took place. Petra has all the items listed above from the Quran and the Islamic traditions. Everything that we see in the Quran and the Islamic traditions fit Petra. None of them fit Mecca. Thus, could it be Petra that all these places were referring to? What's more, take a look at Ad, Thamud, Midian. Remember the people that are referred to in the Quran over and over again? 23 times these people from Ad, 24 times the people from Thamud, 7 times from people from Midian. Take a look and see where they are. They're all around Petra. They lived right around Petra. No wonder whoever was writing or whoever was coming in contact with these people, they were living, whoever that person was, that messenger, that prophet, was living 600 miles further north, not in Mecca. Mecca's way down here, 600 miles between the two. So what's the significance? And this is what we need to unpack today. We don't know anything about Muhammad at all in the 7th century. Now, we do know from outside sources. We do have this from extra Quranic sources. We do have references to Muhammad. The Doctrine of Iacobi, which is right here in the British Library, written in 634, refers to him by name. But it doesn't say where he's from. It doesn't say what he does. It just warns people, be careful of this man, Muhammad. The writings of Sabaeus, written in 660, do talk about Muhammad and warn the Christians to be careful of him, but it doesn't place him in any place, nor does it give him much significance other than the fact that he was a man who did an awful lot of warring. What's interesting is the earliest documents we can find from within Arab sources, from within Muslim sources, the Maghazi documents, which are the earliest part of the Siratul Rasulullah, written by Ibn Hisham in 833. The earliest documents that Ibn Hisham was dependent on are the Maghazi documents. The Maghazi documents means raids. He was a raider. That's what he did. Now can you understand that even his biography from 624 to 632 are about raid after raid after raid after raid. He was involved in 29 raids himself, and he planned another 39 according to his own traditions. That fits the man that we're talking about. It fits the historical character. But nowhere does it say that we can find of these raids being way down in Mecca. It looks like they must have been much further north. His biography doesn't even appear till the 9th century. His city doesn't appear till the 8th century, 741. Thus, much of what we know of Muhammad is written down hundreds of years later and hundreds of miles away. It looks like he is nothing more than a later redaction, possibly Abd al-Malik, putting back onto a historical character that which the man who put back didn't ever know. So Humphrey's conclusions: Islam and the Prophet's life as we know it was not derived from the 7th century, but evolved over a period of 200 to 300 years and redacted back onto the Prophet's life and compiled in the 9th century. And that's what now the historians are now concluding. And you can see why they're coming to that conclusion. Let's summarize this real quickly. New books are being published which question the classical account of Islam. Why are there no Muslim sources for 200 years? That's the first question. Why do the claims they make do not fit the historical record? That's the second claim. Why are all the geographical references so few and confusing? And why do they all seem to be much further north, not where they should be? Why are there so many references to vegetation which would not exist in Mecca? Why is Mecca not even mentioned until 741? And why can we not find any map with Mecca on it until 900 AD? Muhammad died in 632. Takes them almost 300 years to put Mecca on a map. Why is Mecca not on the trade route? So these are all the questions we're asking now. So why do the Qiblas face Petra for the first 100 years, then are confused for the next 100 years, and are not standardized to Mecca until 822, nearly 200 years too late? Therefore, much of what we know about early Islam is in doubt. So here's the million-dollar question. What really happened? Now, I have to be careful because this is what I think. I may change tomorrow. I may have a complete different scenario in 1 year, because we're now getting lots of material that's coming in. But this is where I think, this is what I believe. This is just me. This is what I think happened, looking at everything that we've got so far. And this is a what-if scenario, okay? To make sense of all this, I think we need to go back to Abd al-Malik. And this is what it's not just me saying this, this is what almost all the historians are saying. You need to start with Abd al-Malik, who ruled Islam from 685 to 705. He was the second caliph amongst the Marwanid caliphs. Marwan came into power in 680. Before that was Sufyan family from 661 up until 680. So for the first 20 years of the Umayyad caliphate, it was a Sufyani family. Marwan finally takes over. Marwan's son, Abd al-Malik, is the great Arab reformer. He is known as the great Arab reformer. You can see the Arabs control that part of the world. Therefore, by the time he comes to power, they had controlled that part from 642. So for 40 years, they had now controlled that part of the world, the central part, the area where Jerusalem is, where Damascus is, where also Petra is, also where Mecca and Medina would be. For 40 years, however, they did not control it. They were nothing more than nomads. These nomads that went and took over the Sassanid Empire and then took over the Byzantine Empire. Remember that map I showed you? Remember, those two empires were much more sophisticated. They were empires that had huge cities. The nomadic Arabs did not have big cities. They were nomads. They just had little oases. Therefore, they didn't know how to run cities. That's the first question we should have been asking. Take a look at Islam. Look at how sophisticated it is. Look at all its rules and regulations, all these sharia, these four laws of fiqh. They all would fit in an urban environment, not a nomadic environment. Why haven't we asked this question from the very beginning? How could a nomadic people have such sophisticated rules and regulations dealing with huge metropolitan areas? Unless, of course, these rules and regulations come much later. So what did the nomads do? Well, let me go back, and I should have had this map in here. Remember that map that we have of the Sassanid Empire? They had two groups, the Lakhmids and the Ghassanids, that they would pay to keep the Arabs in the desert. The Ghassanids were paid by the Byzantines, and the Lakhmids were paid by the Sassanians, the Persians. And as long as they got paid, these groups kept the nomads in the desert. But after 200 years of warring with each other, the Sassanids against the Byzantines, they ran out of money. This is well known. Once they ran out of money, they no longer played the Ghassanids, and they no longer played the Lakhmids. And so therefore, the nomadic Arabs could just move right into these empires. And they did. This is well known. This happens all the time. The Mongols did it much later. The Visigoths did it in Europe. Barbarians who come into much more sophisticated environments. What happens when barbarians take over sophisticated environments? They don't know how to run cities. The Arabs didn't know how to run any of these cities. So what did they do? They stayed outside the cities. They built garrison towns. But someone had to run these cities. Who would they have chosen? Well, they chose people like them. People who also came from Abraham, but not through Ishmael, through Isaac. Cousins, Jews and Christians, who did know how to live in cities, and they were also very literate, and they were also very academic. And that's why they used the Jews and Christians to run the cities for them, because they were cousins of Abraham, people of the book, Ahl-e-Kitab. What's more, these people, because they were so close to them, then took on a status called Mawli or Mawali. This is well known, that they took on like an indentured status. They could not actually be Muslims unless they converted, but there was no such idea of Muslim at this time. There was no name of people called Muslim. There was no religion called Islam. We don't have those references until 690. So for 40 years, these Arabs were dependent on the Jews and Christians to run everything for them. Now, what happens after 40 years? You can see the problem. By the time Abd al-Malik comes to power, he realizes that there is no Arab identity. He needed an Arab identity. You want to create your own identity. It's very clear that the Arabs did not have a prophet. It's very clear that the Arabs did not have a book like the Jews and Christians had. They had a whole line of prophets. They had whole slews of books, 66 books. Nothing in the line of Ishmael. But you're the ones that now control the world. You control all these Jews and Christians. So we know, and this is well known, that Abd al-Malik is known as the great Arab reformer. He's the one that introduces Arabic as the international language. He is the one that introduces this Arab identity. This is well known. We can see that because when you look at Abd al-Malik, take a look at the coins, and they're right here in the British Museum. Look at the coins. So the coins that the Byzantines had were the emperor with two retainers on either side, and then they would have an orb with the Byzantine cross. On the back side is the Byzantine cross. When the Arabs took over, they had to keep the same coinage so they could still continue having commerce with all the people in that type of the world. But what they did is they took off the Byzantine emperor and they put the caliph here. So this is the caliph with two retainers. No longer is there an orb with a cross, you notice. The backside still looks like a cross, but it's missing the cross piece. So no one would confuse that this is a cross to make it Arab. All right, but how can you have images of caliphs on the back of coins? Are Muslims allowed to have images anywhere? This is anathema. So how can these coins, which continue, these are the coins that are introduced by the Umayyads, the first Muslims supposedly, right? Coins, every caliph had their image on their coin. Until you get to Abd al-Malik. Abd al-Malik first introduces himself with an image. But then he takes it off and he introduces these coins in 691. In 691, he introduces coins with only Arab script. He takes off the image and introduces an Arab script. And take a look what's on that coin. For the first time, you see the Shahada. That's the first time we see the Shahada. Ah, I lie. It's the second time we see the Shahada. The first time we see the Shahada is on the Dome of the Rock. Who builds the Dome of the Rock? I've got a bad cold, by the way, and a fever, so I'm trying to fight my fever simultaneously with this water. Who is the one that builds the Dome of the Rock? It's Abd al-Malik. The Dome of the Rock is considered to be the third most holy shrine in all of Islam, right? Am I correct on that? Ask any Muslim why the Dome of the Rock is built, and they will tell you, well, that's where Muhammad went to the seven heavens. Remember I said that earlier tonight, right? That's the story that happens in 621. It's called a Miraj, and it's to commemorate that event, which means that building should have some reference to that occasion, right? Take a look at the Dome of the Rock. Look where it's situated. See, Abd al-Malik does not live in Jerusalem. He does not live in Medina. He lives in Damascus. Why in the world does he not live in Mecca, if that's the seat of the world, if that's where God is? Why doesn't he have his capital in Mecca, or at least in Medina? He's way up in Damascus, about 1,000 miles further north. But then he comes to Jerusalem in 691 and builds this large building, the Dome of the Rock. Take a look where it is. Here is the Church of the Sepulchre, which is the center of Christianity at that time. The Dome of the Rock is built on the other valley, across the valley from, and higher up. He builds it higher up so it has ascendancy. It's bigger than the Church of the Sepulchre. It's the biggest building of its kind. Basically, what he's doing is, we are now the rulers. We are now greater than you Christians. We now have the biggest building of our time in 691. And then what does he do on the inner ambulatories? This is the only part of the building. So he uses Byzantine architecture to build the building, much larger than and more prominent than any other Christian building, in the holiest city for Jews and Christians. That's why it's not in Damascus or Mecca. But it's supposed to refer to the Miraj. But take a look at the inscriptions. Now, remember, just to remind you, the Dome of the Rock has been destroyed and rebuilt 11 times. All right, so the dome that we're looking at today is not the original dome. The only original part of the dome that still exists today are these two inner ambulatories in the middle, in the center. These two colonnades right here. That and that. Those are the only part of the dome that is from the original building. All right? So you need to look at the inscriptions on those inner ambulatories. And when you look at those inscriptions, take a look at them and you will see there's nothing at all about the Miraj. There's nothing at all about Muhammad going up to the seven heavens, coming back down to heavens, meeting Moses and going back and forth between Allah and Moses, or 50 prayers. Yet that's why Muslims tell us the building was built. So what's on those inscriptions? Well, take a look. Surah 1112. There is no God but God. He is one. He has no associate. Who's that against? Jesus. Say, He is God, the one, God, the eternal beside of all. He begetteth not, nor was begotten. Who is that against? Jesus, the begotten Son. And there is none comparable unto him. Muhammad is the messenger of God. Here you see Muhammad's name introduced. This is the first time Muhammad's name is introduced on any Arab inscription or architecture. This is the beginning of the introduction of Muhammad. And it's on the Dome of the Rock. In contradistinction to who? To Jesus. Surah 4, Ayah 171. O people of the scripture, do not exaggerate in your religion, nor utter aught concerning Allah save the truth. The Messiah, Jesus, son of Mary, was only a messenger of Allah. See, it even confronts the fact that Jesus is nothing more than a messenger. His word which he conveyed unto Mary and his spirit from. So believe in Allah and his messenger. Say not three. There is the Trinity. It's attacking the Trinity. Cease. It is better for you. Allah is only one God. Far is it removed from his transcendent majesty that he should have a son. So it's attacking Jesus' divinity, it's attacking the Trinity, and it's attacking his sonship, all in one verse. Surah 4, Ayah 171. This is an attack against Jesus. From the very beginning that we now know, the earliest inscriptions are confronting our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise be to God, who hath not taken unto himself a son, and who hath no partner. There it again, attacking against the son of Jesus and his supposed partnership with God. Nor hath he any protecting friend through dependence. He's not dependent on anybody, and certainly not Jesus. Now, why is it no one's noticed this before? If you want to find out why Abdul Malik built that building, and why he made it higher than the Church of the Sepulchre and across the valley on the highest point of Jerusalem, just look at the inscriptions. He's now introducing his own prophet, greater than Jesus. His name is Muhammad. He is the messenger of God. So if you're going to create an identity, you've got to have your own prophet. Because so far, they've been dependent on all the Jews and Christian prophets. That's why 19 of the prophets that are listed in the Quran all come through Isaac. Where is the prophet that comes through Ishmael? Only Ishmael's name is there. They need a prophet to create that identity. They build the building. They introduce his name. And then they put it on the coins. The coins are coined the next year. Significance? He is the one that introduces this identity, beginning with the Dome of the Rock in 691. It's larger than any other non-Arab structure. It's facing the Arab sanctuary, Petra. It incorporates inscriptions against Byzantine Christianity. It introduces their faith. This is the first time we see the name Islam on the Dome of the Rock. It introduces their people. This is the first time we see reference to Muslims. And it introduces their prophet. This is the first time we see a reference to Muhammad. Isn't that interesting? But this is 60 years after Muhammad died. 60 years later, these three are introduced on the Dome of the Rock. More than that, the caliphal protocols. Remember I told you about Yehuda Nevo. Yehuda Nevo has probably done the best work. He's from the University of Jerusalem, head of department there, and he went all around trying to find inscriptions, the earliest inscriptions from the 7th century. And he came across the caliphal protocols. So these are the protocols. These are the official documents written by the caliphs from the Sufyani period all the way up into the Marwanid period. And he noticed that every one of these official documents always began with the Bismillah. But it's not the Bismillah we know today. Bismillah, Al-Rahman, Al-Rahim is not there. It's a completely different Bismillah. What's more, it doesn't talk about Muhammad. There's no reference in any of these caliphal protocols about people called Muslims, about a religion called Islam, about a prophet named Muhammad, or about a book called the Quran. missing in all these protocols. Yet these are supposedly the first Muslim protocols by the caliphs, the first Muslim caliphs. This continues right up until Abd al-Malik. And then he comes across Abd al-Malik's protocols. And that he noticed in 691, almost overnight, Muhammad's name is introduced. It happens overnight. His name is introduced, the Quran is introduced, the name Muslim is introduced, and so is the name Islam. This is all introduced overnight in 691 and in 692. And from that time on, every protocol starts with the Bismillah and the Shahada, that there is only one God but God, and Muhammad is his prophet. What's interesting, the earliest Shahada that he came across says there is only one God but God, and he has no partners. Now hold on a minute. That's not in the Shahada today. So even the earliest Shahada was an attack against Jesus Christ, the partner, supposedly, of God. Then he mints coins in 692, and that's where he takes off his image and introduces the Shahada on those coins that I showed earlier. So what's the possible scenario that we're coming up to? Once he introduces Muhammad, he then needs a revelation. See, every prophet has to have a book, has to have a revelation. And that's why the earliest Quranic texts are on the Dome of the Rock. That's the first time we see Quranic texts. It's on the Dome of the Rock. But it does not equate with the Quran that we have today. We'll talk more about that next week. The earliest Quranic manuscripts begin to appear during his reign and his son Al-Walid. You don't know what I'm talking about. You have to wait till next week. We're going to show you the dates of the earliest manuscripts next week. None of them are complete, nor do they parallel today's Quran completely. They continue to be changed and corrected up until the 9th century. Now, this is all new to you. You have to come back next week and we'll show you what we're talking about. The sanctuary Petra is then destroyed in an earthquake in 713. What happens whenever a sanctuary is destroyed? Well, as the people know, whenever their sanctuary is destroyed, that means God no longer has favor with that sanctuary. You've got to change your sanctuary, because this is God's way of saying, this no longer is my sanctuary. Because earthquakes always come from God back then. So where are you going to change it to? Well, you're going to go back to where the Marwanids came from. The Marwanid family comes from the Hijaz, from Central Arabia. So they then bring it down and they introduce it in Mecca. That's why Mecca was chosen. But see, Mecca doesn't make sense. Let me tell you why. Take a look at Mecca today. What do they do in Mecca? Well, they go around that Kaaba seven times. Well, who does that? Where does the number seven come from? It comes from the Bible, right? Then they run back and forth between two pillars, the Marwa and the Safa Hills. What's that got to do with God? Why do they run back and forth? Muslims will tell you that's because that was Hagar who had Ishmael. She was looking for water, and she went back and forth, back and forth. She didn't find any water. So why celebrate something that doesn't make any sense? She never succeeded in anything. Why celebrate it? Then they go outside and they do a sacrifice. They come back to the where the Jamarats are. The Jamarats, those pillars. And they throw seven stones or 49 stones or 72 stones. Multiplicity of seven. There's the perfect number again. Ask any Muslim why they throw those stones. And they'll tell you because that's the devil. But there are three of them. There's not three devils. So where do these three come from? Ooh, I love that. I think we know where they come from. Alat, Al-Manat, and Al-Uzza in Surah 53, Ayah 19 and 20. These are the goddesses. These are the goddesses of Alat and Allah. See, Allah is a Nabataean name. Alat is the feminine form of Allah. The Nabataeans believed in Allah as their God. The wife of Allah is Alat. So Allah has a wife and a daughter named Al-Manat. Ooh, I love this. But every Muslim tells me that Allah is one. Surah 4, Ayah 171 that I just read to you is God is one, say not three, and God has no son. Surah 6, Ayah 101 and Ayah 102 says that God has no wife, right? Well, he may not have a son, but he certainly has a wife. Her name's Alat. And he has a daughter. Her name's Al-Manat. You've got the wrong God. It looks like these may be, possibly, I can't prove it yet, These may be the Jamarats, may be the three goddesses, the Nabataean goddesses that they're throwing there. Because this is the reason to get rid of idolatry, you then throw the stones. What's interesting is they don't have any theological significance. So where did they come from? It looks like Mecca was a pagan, probably a Nabataean pagan shrine that they took over, kept the practices that were still there, and tried to infuse some theological meaning. But it doesn't make sense when you look and see who God is and what he has done historically. So they chose Mecca. Now that the Muslims have a prophet, Muhammad, and they have a revelation, the Quran, they've got to put together the Quran. Ooh, wait till next week. Wait till you show you what we have found. Now they got a revelation and a prophet, they need a sanctuary, so they choose Mecca. Now that they have the three ingredients, they now need to have a history. You've got to create a history. You've got to put Muhammad in his own place. You've got to put him in his own milieu. Now can you see why it took them for another 100 years to finally get that together? And that's why Ibn Hisham was given 600,000 of these akbar. I believe that's probably true. He was given 600,000. Of all these supposed different histories, he threw out 98% of it and only retained 2% of it, and that's what we have al-Bukhari take. He is the first one to write down the sayings of this prophet. Take a look at al-Bukhari. There is contradiction after contradiction, and they do not make sense, and they contradict the Quran. We won't even get into that tonight. So now you've got the Sirah with Ibn Hisham, then you need the Sirah is Ibn Hisham, then you need the sayings, the Hadith, and that's with al-Bukhari. That comes in 870. By the time they get the Sirah in 833 and the Hadith in 870, they also need to have rules and regulations. Take a look when all four schools start to appear. The Hanafi school, the Maliki school, the Shafi school, the Hanbali school. They all begin to appear in 820 and later. Nothing before 820. That's the 9th century. 200 years later and hundreds of miles away. Why? Because now the laws have to be created. And that's why they borrowed right, left, and center from Roman law and also from Sassanid law, Persian law. And then once you get that, then you've got to make sense of the Quran. By that time, the Quran is formed, but it is full of contradictions. Just take a look at the Quran, borrowing from many different sources. If you borrow, you've got to make sense of it. That's why the tafsir had to be created. And the tafsir do not start to begin to appear until the 10th century, 300 years later. By the 9th century, they now have the book, the man, the place, and the story. All four. But that's 200 to 300 years too late. And a new religion is formed and growing. Yet this did not happen a mere 22 years, but evolved, it looks like, between 200 to 300 years. Now can you see why the historians are coming to their conclusions? Let's sum up what we've just now found. New books are being published which question the classical account of Islam's beginning, asking questions such as, why are there no Muslim sources for 200 years? In a time and place that they should have had sources. There's no way to say, there's no reason for them not to have these sources. Remember, they owned these major cities, Basra, Baghdad, Damascus, Jerusalem, and Cairo, and except for Jerusalem, they still control those cities. And everything they wrote on was on parchment because they were rulers. They were not poor and oppressed like the Christians. The Christians did not have access to parchment in the first century. They were poor. They could only use papyrus. Papyrus disintegrates within 100 years. Every one of these scripts were written on parchment during the Islamic caliphal part because the caliphs ruled all the world. They had plenty of money to make these documents. Why are the geographical references so few and confusing? Why do they all seem to be much further north? Why are there so many references to vegetation which wouldn't exist in Mecca? Why is Mecca not even mentioned until 741, nor included on any map until 900? Why is Mecca not even on the international trade route? Why do all the Qiblas face Petra for the first 100 years, then are confused the next 100, and aren't standardized to Mecca until 822, 200 years too late? What is Abd al-Malik's role in all of this? Does a nascent Islam really begin with him? And I would suggest it all begins with Abd al-Malik. We're going to prove that next week, and you'll see why. So, what about Muhammad? Since much of what we know about early Islam is now in doubt, since much of the Quran is also in doubt, we'll see that next week, since nothing is known of Muhammad until the late 7th century, or Mecca until the 8th century, or his history until the 9th century, hundreds of years later and hundreds of miles away, can we conclude that Islam is nothing more than a later redaction possibly begun by Abd al-Malik, then continued on by his descendants al-Walid and others, proving Muhammad had nothing to do with the Quran. So who is he and what is his purpose? They've got the wrong man at the wrong place doing the wrong thing at the wrong time. What about Jesus? We know where Jesus was born. That's pretty clear, in Bethlehem. We know where Jesus grew up, in Nazareth. We know where he died, in Jerusalem. We know what he did especially for the last 3 years. We know from eyewitness accounts, Matthew and John. We know from hostile accounts. Look at Thallus, Tacitus, and Josephus. They are the ones that tell us about the crucifixion. They are the ones that give us his name. Thallus and Phlegon were debating about the crucifixion in 52 AD. These were Greek historians. These were not Christians. And they mentioned that when Jesus died 20 years earlier, because 52 AD is just 20 years after the crucifixion, within 20 years they were debating the fact that when he died, the sun went dark and the earth shook. That's a Greek historian's. Tacitus, who had nothing good to say about Christianity, he hated Christians. Yet he's the one that says that this Jesus died during the time of Pontius Pilate under the rule of Tiberius. In 33 AD. That's why we know that he died in 33 AD, because of Tiberius, the historian writing at the end of the first century. So there's a Roman historian giving us reference to Jesus. What about a Jewish historian like Josephus, the greatest historian of his age, writing in Rome? He says in the early second century, he talks about Jesus. He even mentions the brother of Jesus, mentions about the death of Jesus, and mentions about the death of his brother James. And then curiously, he also happens to mention that the Christians believe that Jesus rose again. The only reference we have to the resurrection from outside a biblical source comes from Josephus, a Jewish historian. So there you have a Greek historian, you have a Roman historian, you have a Jewish historian, all talking about Jesus and his death. That's why we know and we can be sure of what he died and where he died. These were all written within, certainly the accounts that were those by the eyewitness, within 50 to 60 years, the extra hostile accounts within at least 100 to 120 years. No doubt about his historicity. Thus, we have the right man at the right place, doing the right thing at the right time. That's why I love my Jesus. We don't have any problem with him. These kind of questions you don't hear anywhere about Jesus. No one suggests he didn't live or suggests that he didn't die. Now, there are some, the Muslims don't believe he died, but where do they get their reference from? From the Quran. One verse, Surah 4, Ayah 157. Surah 19, Ayah 33 completely confronts it, contradicts it. Surah 3, Ayah 55 also contradicts, but no, they go with Surah 4, 157. Even the Quran is not sure if he died. Many Muslims today don't know who died. They know someone died. They all agree that, but they think maybe someone else was given his image and he was put on Jesus' place and he went up on the cross. Can you imagine someone getting the image of Jesus and not saying anything about it? Don't you think the man on the cross would have said something? I would have. You've got the wrong guy. More than that, you mean John didn't know Jesus, didn't know the man on his cross? He'd been with him for 3 years. He was his favorite disciple. What about Mary? She knew her own son. Would not a mother who'd known her son for 33 years not have known if that was her son on the cross? And why did the man on the cross not even intimate that he shouldn't have been there? Look and see what he says. Is there any doubt that he knew what he was doing? They're on the cross. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's my Jesus. Ooh, I love the historicity of Jesus. You look and see who Jesus is and his historicity. N.T. Wright mentions that when you look at Jesus and compare him, if you take a look at Jesus, you need to find out what happened historically in the first century to see if we've got him placed right. And he says, take a look and see what Josephus says, that are the three major debates that are happening there in Judaism in the first century. He says the debate was on the church, kingdom of God. That the kingdom of God was going to be the Davidic kingdom, that they were going to bring back that kingdom of God. That was the debate as to what the kingdom would look like. The laws of God was the second debate that happened right through there in the first century. And then thirdly, the temple itself. Those are the three things that the Jews were debating because they wanted to bring back that kingdom. They wanted to bring back those laws and they wanted to bring back the temple from Solomon's time. Now, these debates would have made no sense after 70 AD, because 70 AD, Jerusalem was destroyed, and the Jews were all thrown out of Jerusalem. There would be no kingdom left anymore. There certainly would, the laws would make no sense anymore, and the temple would have been destroyed. Take a look at Jesus in the New Testament. Does he talk about the kingdom of God? Yes, he does. All the time he talks about the kingdom of God. It's no longer a place, it's a relationship where there are two or three gathered in my name. He redefines the kingdom as a relationship with him. No longer a place over there, it's with me. Does he talk about the laws of God? Look at Matthew 5. For I have not come to destroy the law, he says, but to fulfill it. And then he gives six different applications to what he means there in Matthew 5. That's my Jesus. Does he not talk about the temple? Absolutely. You destroy the temple, and in 3 days I will rise it again. We've got the right man saying the right thing at the right time in the right place. That's why I love the historical account. When you look and see whether we've got the historical record for Jesus, it all fits to a bit. What about the Quran? What does it do with Issa? Does the Quran ever say that Issa talks about the kingdom of God? Not once. Does he talk about the laws of God? Not once. Does he talk about the temple? Not once. Strike three, you're out, as we say in baseball. Folks, you've got the wrong man at the wrong place. Even with Jesus, historically, he makes no sense. And he spends his whole time in the Quran talking about how he's not divine and showing how great Muhammad was. That's his mission? That's why when you come back and compare Jesus with Muhammad, take a look at the problem they have with Muhammad. And this is going to change even by next year. But can you see what a great man we've got? What a great history he has. So what do we do from here? Well, the historians have set the stage, we move it on. The questions they ask, we now research and expand. We must confront Islam's historical foundation. We must challenge Muhammad and the Quran. We must demand the same of our Bible and Jesus Christ. We must bring both into the public sphere and then let people come to their own conclusions. Why? Because similar historical questions have already been asked of Christianity, and every one of them has been answered. We need to bring our friends home, folks. Not to Muhammad, but back to Jesus. Not to the Quran, but back to the Bible. Not to Islam, but back to Christianity. Do you all agree? Let's pray. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this evening, because what we have done here, Lord, is to take that which is neutral, that which we don't own. We're looking at artifacts. We're looking at buildings. We're looking at timelines. We're looking at all the historical evidence that anybody can look at, and we're coming to conclusions. And the conclusions we're coming to, Lord, do not fit Islam well. But the conclusions we know of your God, of your Son who came down to earth 2,000 years ago and who lived for 33 years, that history, we can stand. Not only stand on, but we can also use in every one of our, not only our debates, but every one of our discussions. May we bring people home to you, the real historical God who became man, who lived for 33 years. And yes, who died and rose again. Lord, may we be proud of what you have done. May we not keep quiet. In everything we do, may we represent you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.